Hello and welcome to In the Spotlight with Quocirca, the definitive podcast on digital disruption in the print industry. I'm Louella Fernandes, Director of Quocirca, and today I'm joined by David Mills, CEO of Ricoh Europe. Today we'll be discussing the intelligent and sustainable workplace. So welcome, David. It's great to have you on the show today.
Louella, it's absolutely fantastic to be here.
Great. So we've got quite a lot to cover. So could you maybe just start off with telling us a bit about your career journey to date and your role at Ricoh Europe?
Okay. Well, starting with my role at Ricoh, I'm the European CEO. So what that means is I've got 22 operating companies out there, a fantastic indirect sort of the dealer channel, which are our partners, extensive. And that sort of goes from the Middle East to Africa, on all the way up to Greenland, so quite an extensive coverage. And I've been with Ricoh now for since 1989, actually, when I was acquired by Icon. So that was a great acquisition for me. And I've been with Ricoh ever since, sort of progressing, first of all, running the UK, then running Ricoh Europe for Ricoh in Japan. So a great sort of a career move for me, and it's been a fantastic kind of experience. And I must tell you a little bit about myself. You know, it's very important. I'm a keen skier, which is kind of good. I also have two new granddaughters, which are a recent addition in the last 2 years, which has been absolutely fantastic. So it's really, really great. And the social side is as good as the work.
Yeah, no, I remember a while ago you did the hike for the Alzheimer's charity, and that was really impressive. Was that a couple of years ago now that you did that?
Actually, that was 4 years ago. So time does fly. Walking, doing the Pennine Way, and I've just recently done the Coast to Coast walk for charity as well, which was another great experience. And I apologise today, I'm looking a bit dishevelled because I'm growing a moustache from November. So keen on the camera.
Oh, okay. No, it's very impressive. No, so that's, that's really interesting to hear that background. And as I say, the discussion today is about the future of the intelligent and sustainable workplace. And I know Ricoh is actually probably one of the first manufacturers to really change its positioning to be a digital transformation provider. I think you were one of the first ones that really sort of focused and pivoted in that direction. So could you maybe talk a bit about the journey to where Ricoh is today and what your strategy is going forward?
Well, you know, first of all, print is at the heart of everything that we do. And, you know, that's what we've been known for a number of years, whether that's commercial printing or whether it's kind of office printing. Well, recently, sort of 3D printing we've been into as well. So print is kind of at the heart of everything that we do. But we did recognize probably 4 or 5 years ago now that print volumes were in a decline, especially in the office type of environment. So we kind of had to pivot Ricoh into different areas, which we've been doing over that time, and really trying to make sure that we can service our customers in these new areas of expansion, you know, turning that to digital transformation and making sure that we can support our customers as they go along that journey. And we've had a group that's been done by acquisition, but it's also been done organically and kind of using the talents that we acquire to actually enable us to progress and move the business forward.
Yeah, so you're very much focused on sort of digital services, and you know, I think we see in the industry that's been a real need for legacy companies to really adapt and innovate in those areas, and as you say, sort of move towards these more sort of digital transformation-led services. Are you seeing any particular changes in how your customers are responding now that they're moving back to the office in terms of what services they're looking for from Ricoh?
Well, yeah, we put our sort of services that we provide into different categories. Now, the first thing we've got is sort of the digital workplace. So, you know, what that actually means, probably a lot of workflow, making sure people can transfer documents everywhere, they can work any place, any time, any kind of workwear. The next one is the sort of business process management. You know, that's another key bucket for us because, you know, businesses now, if they're working anywhere, I've got to have a process that can deliver the goods or they can do the job at any particular point. And the second, the third thing is really sort of digital experience. And, you know, employees to be kept to companies or want to retain a companies, they need to have a great experience. If they don't have a great experience, well, they get frustrated and want to move on. And also the two kind of big areas of growth that we're seeing at the moment is firstly, cybersecurity. You know, everybody has that problem with ransomware. You know, everybody is kind of struggling in that area to cope with the number of attacks that companies get on a daily basis. And also cloud and infrastructure management. You know, if people are going to work from home, they need more capacity, you need the network to be quick, you need to be VPN needs to be good, and you need to make sure you've got access to the company information. So basically, we keep it in those kind of five buckets of how we're trying to help our customers progress in this new digital world.
Yeah, and I think you raised a really good point there around employee experience, because as you mentioned, you know, I think the pandemic has really prompted this great resignation, and it's really important for companies to make sure their employees are engaged to avoid losing talent. And what is Ricoh doing as a company for its own employees in terms of supporting hybrid work?
Well, it's a great question, and it's kind of clearly on our mind. And we're kind of looking at what's happening on a daily basis. And we've definitely got that effect that Tuesdays, Wednesdays and Thursdays are very popular. and Mondays and Fridays, not so popular. But I think what we've done ourselves really is really operate a hybrid working policy. So we've said to our employees, we expect them back into the office 50% of the time, and 50% of the time they can work where they like, whether that's at home or in a different type of environment or kind of out of the office. And we think that's so important to make sure that we can attract talent, we can attract good people, and we can keep people kind of motivated as we move forward. I think also due to our own experience and what we've been looking at, we thought, well, how are we going to make sure that we've got enough desk availability? Because with COVID, you know, we couldn't use our office. We tightly packed, actually, in London, the office I'm in today. And if everybody turned up, we couldn't socially distance. So we sort of put together our own application called Ricoh Spaces, which we've been using really successfully and now selling that to the marketplace. And what that actually does is allows employees to log on an app and actually book their desk or book a meeting room, book lunch even if they want it. And all that's arranged through the app. And that enables us to sort of monitor activity when people are coming in and when they're not, but also make sure people have got a desk when they come in, which I think is quite important too.
Yeah, and I think with Ricoh Spaces, a really interesting proposition because, as you say, I think there's some reluctance for some employees to go back to the office because of health and safety concerns. And I guess these kind of applications really help employees know when they can go back to the office and can sort of book various areas. So is that part of your overall proposition around MPS, or is that a separate service that you're offering in addition?
Those sort of five things that I mentioned early on, this comes clearly in the digital workplace. So we're trying to digitalize the workplace and give our customers an opportunity to go down that route and give ourselves the opportunity to make sure that people are enjoying the experience of coming back to work. I love being in the office, by the way. I'm one of those people that prefers to be in the office and not at home. But
especially with two grandchildren running around.
Exactly. Especially my wife looks after them on a Thursday.
Yeah, and I think that's the thing. It's a real balance, isn't it, in terms of, you know, our research showed that about 70% of employees actually want to continue with a hybrid approach to working. And I think it's really great to hear that Ricoh's, you know, established its own hybrid work contracts for its employees.
And I can book a desk anywhere in my European or North American network. which is amazing. So I could go and work in Pittsburgh and book a desk, I suppose. But not that I'd want to travel to America at the moment.
And just on that point, actually, around MPS that I mentioned earlier, are you seeing companies are really looking to reassess their MPS contracts and look at their sort of printer fleet in terms of how they're operating that in the office and extend that to the home environment as well? You know, how's Ricoh positioned in terms of supporting those two environments?
I think the first thing to clear, I think companies don't know yet. And, you know, I think there's got to be a return to some kind of normality. And I don't think we're there yet. What we're seeing, and I think it works differently in different countries, actually. In Southern Europe, people are generally back to work now. And our recovery is to about 90% of it was in 2019. So almost there. My home country, the UK, is the worst, and we're only at sort of 75, actually pushing to 80% now of kind of activity compared to 2019. So a quite a change of which country you look at. We are not experiencing a lot of companies looking at sort of changing their fleets just yet. A few sort of local authorities and government bodies did at first and sort of said, we don't really need photocopiers or printers anymore. But in fact, they've changed their minds, actually, and they do need them as people have returned to the office. So I think we need to watch this space. We need to kind of see how it develops. And there's one thing clear, though. I don't think we're going to return back to the old days. We have to be looking to the future to offer our customers different services and the more far-reaching services of what we're trying to do at Ricoh.
Yeah, absolutely. It's about supporting customers' really rapidly evolving needs, you know, wherever they are, whether they're in the home or in the office. And I think that's really interesting to see how that plays out for the print industry, because I think, like you say, it's still uncertain times and we don't know still whether print volumes will recover to pre-COVID levels.
And that's why we're trying to offer these new services, actually, because they definitely need sort of desk and space management.
Yeah.
Cybersecurity is just massive at the moment, and we've got a big push in that area. You know, cloud and infrastructure, wow, what massive spends taking place in that kind of area, because people need to change how they're structured to help their employees work from home and in the office.
Yeah, and I think that goes back to what I said originally, is that Ricoh had already kind of repositioned itself in terms of being a digital transformation and IT services provider. Can you talk a bit about the IT services capability? Because I know you've had some really interesting engagements, as you say, particularly due to cybersecurity requirements and the cloud. So maybe you could sort of give us some examples of customers that you're working with.
Yeah, that'd be good. Yes, many really. I think a lot of, on the cybersecurity front, it's a lot. Mainly it's focused on health service and local governments and sort of government institutions. I think they're the ones that have been targeted the most. I did read in the paper yesterday, Graf, you know, the jewellery people, they actually got attacked yesterday. Not a customer of ours, by the way, but they got attacked. So it is kind of out there. And so that cybersecurity is definitely one of the big things. We also, people increasing their capacities. You know, the telcos, when we work with quite a few telcos across Europe, their capacities have been enhanced substantially over the last couple of years through COVID, and we've been supporting the main players to do that at Ricoh, and so that's been fantastic business for ourselves. So that's been a key area. I think also we had an incredibly successful acquisition at DocuWare. I think our timing, it was perfect. We didn't know COVID was coming, obviously. When we just acquired that, I think the month before it started to hit. But then DocuWare is obviously, as people probably know, is sort of document storage and retrieval. and then the workflow on top of that, for mainly for small, medium-sized businesses. And that has been just such a boom. It's been fantastic. And our main problem is capacity and actually installing it at customers and getting them up to speed. So we've been recruiting heavily in the sort of professional services area to do that. But that's been an incredible success and a fantastic product. If anybody's not using it, please take a look.
Well, actually, no, because I did want to talk to you about DocuWare, because I know you led that acquisition. And in terms of your go-to-market, you know, you talked about your recruiting professional services capabilities, but is there something that you're targeting broadly with your MPS offering and adding that onto MPS, or is it very much targeted at a smaller customer that, you know, you may just have direct channels to?
Funny enough, we when we bought it, we focused definitely on the smaller customer. I think the massive exercise we did was train our 3,000 salespeople to actually have a simple understanding of it. You know, it's a very complicated product, and you're never going to learn everything. And in fact, if you learn it all, it's too much. You can never take it to the customer. So, you need to start off by doing sort of storage and retrieval or accounts payable or HR records and keep it really, really kind of straightforward. So we spend a lot of time and effort trying to train our sales force to be able to communicate with our customers, and I think we did that successfully. And also our engineers, because you need somebody to go along and install it, do the training, and help people through the new process, the new rigor of processing documents through that kind of workflow tool. So it's been a fantastic experience, a fantastic journey, and we've been achieving unbelievable growth rates, more than double digit.
Oh wow! But I think, you know, like you say, the timing was great, because it was just at the onset of the pandemic and organisations wanting to fast track their digitisation efforts, and I guess that really played into Ricoh's strengths in having those capabilities to drive that forward.
It did, and obviously it's an addition to our MPS tools and everything that we offer our customers. We thought that a lot of it would be due to our machine, because we've obviously introduced an easy sort of onboarding application where you can scan documents on our machine straight into DocuWare. But in fact, customers are doing that electronically anyway, and so. That's not worked out as we first thought, but still, the product has helped us significantly achieve one of our objectives, which is sort of digitalizing the workplace.
Yeah, and I think, as you say, I think there's a lot of vendors that are, developing these workflow apps that are integrated with the MFPs, but what we're seeing is that it's kind of very low uptake on that unless it's linked to some sort of enterprise platforms. But I think, because of the fact that many people haven't been in the office, that just having something separate that stands alone is just as compelling.
Yeah, it is. It surprised us at first. We thought that would be sort of a compelling thing that would happen, and it's not. The other thing we've noticed now, because we're used to the product and we've been selling the product for 2 years, is that we're moving into the enterprise space sort of very, very quickly. And some of our larger customers are using it for specific sort of functions. One of a big sort of warehouse provider is using it for warehouse processing of goods received notes and documents along those lines now, which is fantastic. So it's not just small and medium-sized business, it's also going into the enterprise space.
Just out of interest, because you obviously need to attract the channel partners and the professional services capability that have those skills and expertise around, whether it's cloud, IT-centric expertise and document management. Is that a challenge for Ricoh to get the right people, given the landscape that we're in at the moment?
Yeah, it is actually. First of all, we want to remain loyal to our partners. The partners have been with us for many, many, many years. Some seem to be here longer than Ricoh, so I don't know how that kind of works, but incredible journey we've had with many, many of our partners. And we're trying to help them sort of progress, and DocuWare has been a fantastic addition for some of those. Some of them just want to move product, and that's okay. That's okay too. But some of them want to come on the journey with us, and we need to help them do that. And we're trying to create this suite of digital assets that our partners can use going forward. And we're out trying to do some more acquisitions to develop those digital assets that we can use sort of internally, but also our partners can use. We think that's so important to the future.
Yeah, no, I think it's great for the channel because, like you said, there are some channel partners that are kind of happy with the status quo and we're going to focus on product-centric, hardware-driven business. But for those that really want to add value to those sales and build their solutions capabilities, yeah, something like DocuWare is a great fit.
Great fit.
So I wanted to move on to talk about sustainability. I mean, this is quite a big topic, but, you know, I know that ESG is quite a strong focus, well, you know, for any company today, but particularly for Ricoh for some time. Can you sort of maybe share your thoughts on why you think ESG is such a hot topic at the moment and how Ricoh is actually adapting its strategy across all of those areas, sort of environmental, social and governance?
I think it's a hot topic for a number of reasons, and it's been part of our culture for kind of years. I think to attract talent in the future, a company's got to have a purpose, and I think that purpose is not just the P&L or even the balance sheet. It's got to be what the company stands for and what it does. And I think the regulations that are coming in from the EU are also very, very significant, and we are all going to have to present what we do. But I think Ricoh tries to do that out of its sort of heart and built into everything that we do on a daily basis. That's why I'm growing a mustache at the moment, and I've got probably 40 colleagues that are doing it with me in Ricoh Europe. And so that's kind of part of our culture. And another example I saw on Friday, actually, I was at our factory in Telford, and they've been they're on a journey to becoming self-sufficient in terms of energy in the sort of next 10 years or so. And they've built a significant solar farm on the land that they've got up there to try to achieve that objective. So it's ingrained in our culture, in everything that we do. I think it's going to become compulsory. As you report your P&L in the future, you've got to be reporting what are you doing for the environment in the future as well. So it's got a real, real kind of business need. And, you know, Ricoh was ranked by Forbes as the sort of third best company in Japan for sustainability. So very proud of our achievements in this area, but we've got so much more we need to be doing and got so much more that we need to do in the future. I think in our business, one of the big things is going to become the recycling of our products, our consumable products, our toners, and also the recycling of our machines in the future, more than we've ever done in the past. And that's going to become a very key platform to our development going forward.
Yeah, and I think another area, I don't sort of often discuss this in the podcast, is around diversity and women in technology. But I know Ricoh has quite a strong strategy in this area, and I think particularly in Japan. So I don't know if there's anything you can comment on in terms of Ricoh's focus on getting more women in the boardroom.
In my management team in Europe here, I'm very diverse. I'm sort of 50-50, which is great progress that we've made in the last 5 years, and has brought a fantastic dynamic to Ricoh Europe. We've got some women in sales awards coming up, actually, I think in the next couple of months, and we got 30 people that it's 30 sales ladies that have made the final in that area. So I think we're really proud of that and really trying to push that forward. Very, very important to us going forward.
Yeah, and I think, you know, there's a lot of challenges for the industry in general, you know, being such a traditional industry. And, you know, I think it's great to hear, you know, that sort of initiatives like that.
We need more engineers too.
Yeah, exactly. So, I think we talked a bit about the acquisition of DocuWare, but I just understand that you launched a new internal digital innovation organization. Was that last year? And, you know, we're always talking about Quocirca in terms of how the industry really needs to adapt and innovate and, you know, sort of think more like a software centric technology vendor. So, yeah, could you maybe give me a bit of insight into the rationale behind that?
Yeah, really, really good question. Yeah, we call them sort of our digital factories or our innovation hubs. And it was born around the acquisitions that we've made, really. And we've made 10 acquisitions in the last sort of few years, so quite significant. And all those acquisitions have got some great, great talents in them. And we're trying to pull out those really great bits to then spread across the organization. And that's what we're trying to do. And that's where our sort of cybersecurity came from, that a company called MTI that we bought in the UK, been a great asset, and they do cybersecurity to a very, very high level. And we're trying to pull out the nugget that they've got and enable us to spread that across Europe as an example. And in a way, that's how we did Ricoh Spaces as well, you know, and how we've launched that across Europe and North America and Japan.
Yeah, actually, sort of coming back to sustainability, are you finding that your customers are, obviously, we see that more customers are looking for strong sustainability credentials from their suppliers. But are you seeing that customers are actually looking at how they use Ricoh technology to reduce their own environmental impact? And I know that Ricoh has sustainability services as a separate offering. Is that something that you're seeing is rising higher on the agenda?
Yes, I think it is. I think it does, but it's across that gambit of things that we're trying to do. It's just one of many. And I think that probably sits into the digital workplace in a way. Our customers, I think it's a given now you've got to offer these things. I think it's a given that your machines are going to be the best efficiency possible so people are not wasting power. I think we've got to do an awful lot more about our sustainability around toner and the retrieval of toner and distribution of toner. You know, that's one of my things that I'm working on currently, which I think is really, really important. And we've just got to reduce waste in everything that we do. We need to be reducing waste. And I think people look at, especially our enterprise customers, look to Ricoh to actually do that on a daily basis. And we have to reference everything that we're doing on that. And visit any of our factories and you'll see that on a daily basis, as I did on last Friday. Great to see the solar farm in Telford.
Yeah, no, it sounds really impressive. And I think it's just very clear that Ricoh's really made this transition to sort of focusing on digital services and isn't covering so many different areas. So I just wanted to ask you just a bit more about the IT services side, because we're seeing that a lot of MPS providers are looking to get more skills in that area in IT services. But sometimes it's challenging to develop those skills. So it tends to be the best opportunity to drive that business is to actually partner or collaborate. Are you seeing that your customers that are using IT services, how are the synergies being sort of linked between MPS and IT services? Do you have customers that are already MPS customers that you're delivering IT services to now, or vice versa? Because I think, you know, there's obviously great synergies between those two parts of the business.
It works both ways. The best way it works actually is an IT services company, a customer always becomes a print customer.
Okay.
So if we've got that IT services company first, they always then take print from us, because I think we're still known as that print company, and it is fundamentally still the core of our business. Going from print to IT services is slightly a bit more difficult if you've been providing print for years. And that is why we try to pitch, not to say we'll be your IT services provider, but, you know, we try to offer a solution to the customer so we can gradually show them what we can do. And our sales force are trained to kind of do that recognize those opportunities. It may be as simple as Ricoh Spaces. It may be as large as their cloud and infrastructure services that they're trying to do. And we try to get involved as often as we can. And our sales force is kind of trained to recognize those opportunities and then bring in the experts. There's no way you can train them to do everything. Mm-hmm. So they need to rely on the experts to provide that expert advice to those customers. I think cybersecurity is probably a good, an interesting one, where to many councils in UK or health authorities in the UK, the NHS, we provide services to. And because of their vulnerabilities, because they're constantly being attacked now, we've been able to help them with that cybersecurity kind of solution. And it's only because a salesman said, we can help you with that particular problem. So it's complex. We're getting better at it. IT services business now, we'll hit €1 billion this year. So significant business for us now.
And is that particularly strong in certain regions in Europe or something?
No, one of our strategies has been trying to get geographical coverage, and we haven't done that everywhere. We, if there's any IT services providers looking in from France at the moment, we're keen to acquire in France, because that kind of is a big hole for us. But we've everywhere else we're fairly well covered, and even some of our major accounts in France we're covering from a European perspective. We've built a significant one of the assets that we've built is we call it our IT services SOC in Poland, and basically that SOC has now got 250 people in it. And it manages IT infrastructure for our customers around Europe. That can be any country managed from Warsaw in Poland. And that is a fantastic asset, and we get plaudits about that. And customers, we haven't lost a customer yet. They keep renewing. And we're also looking after global assets of Ricoh's from that facility in Poland, and that's been incredibly successful.
Yeah, it's interesting because I guess the IT services landscape is quite competitive, but it sounds like Ricoh's really managed to sort of gain traction in a lot of those regions with specific customers.
It's the same as anything, you know, Louella. I think if you can provide a good service and be a trusted partner to your customers, I think your services can grow in that customer. And that's what Ricoh tries to do on a daily basis, is deliver a great service so then we can expand and gain the trust so we can expand into other areas.
Yeah, and I think, like you say, it's almost how we sort of discussed it at the beginning of the conversation, but it's about, you know, customer experience. And I think that's become such a huge opportunity now for the print industry to really become more customer centric rather than product centric. And I think, you know, it's been really great to hear how Ricoh's been tackling all those areas of the technology landscape. So I just really wanted to end with a final question in terms of what's next for Ricoh, Ricoh Europe and Ricoh globally. And are there any particular areas or priorities that you'll be focusing on for 2022?
Yeah, I think a couple of them I've mentioned already. So, but I'll focus on a few areas. And I think the first one is employee choice. I think, and I include sort of hybrid working in that. That it's going to bring many opportunities. We've really got to make sure that we help our customers retain employees, because I think if you don't offer the right services, I think that's going to be a massive problem for growing companies in the future, retention of employees. So we need to really give the services that enable our customers to do that. I think another one that's going to become more important, and again I've mentioned it, is organizations need to have a purpose, and that purpose is not just to produce profit. It needs to be all around the sustainability goals and really making sure that the company has got a purpose and is really projecting that in its personality, because I think that's going to be fundamental as we go forward. And then automation and AI is going to be there. Thank goodness for DocuWare. That's going to be really, really good for us. And we need to enhance our capabilities in that area. And finally, mentioned it a few times, cybersecurity is going to be so important to companies to protect their data and to protect their business fundamentally.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I think, you know, that the whole threat landscape is just changing so significantly now because of remote working. So that's a real opportunity for all technology players is to really protect their customers' documents and the networks and so on. So, and, you know, I guess technology with purpose, as you described, you know, that's really the next focus for businesses now as ESG becomes more important. So no, it's been great to have you on today. It's been really interesting to hear what Ricoh is doing. So thanks again, and I really appreciate your time.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining today's episode of In the Spotlight with Quocirca. For more information, please go to quocirca.com and be sure to subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thanks again for joining, and I look forward to seeing you in our next episode.